the truth in his heart. Now, of course, speak of the truth in his heart. Someone said, well, that means I just need to speak the truth in me. No, you speak the truth that is in your heart. The truth comes. Teach. Can the church say amen? Tonight, we want to call your attention to the book of Malachi, chapter 3. And we're going to talk about our speech, the things that we speak and say in terms of what comes out of our mouths, out of the mouths of the believer. There are things that we should be speaking, things that we should be saying, and we should acknowledge that we will benefit from what we speak and from what we say. Can the church say amen? Can the church say amen? And so we many times speak and say things that are to our own detriment and sometimes to the detriment of others. If we say things that we should not say that are to the detriment of others, we many times don't realize that we cannot speak things that are to the detriment of others without saying things that are of detriment to ourselves. Jesus himself said in Matthew 12 and 36, please write this down, in Matthew 12 and 36, every idle word men speak, they should give an account of in the day of judgment. In another place he said, by your words shall ye be justified, and by your words shall ye be condemned. So many times as you all join us that are coming in, we don't realize the significance. Someone say significance. Please open your mouth and say significance, and or the importance of the things that come out of our mouths. An example is a person can be interviewing and can use profanity, and they can cancel their interview and or their opportunity for being hired because their vocabulary is out of control. They're using curse words in the interview. I don't know too many people that have done that. You'd have to be a fool to do something like that. Certainly you would not want to be employed if you went into any kind of interview for employment and began to respond using profanity. But people do. Turn to someone and say, people do strange things. People many times are interviewed and they lie. And the interviewer, as they interview the interviewee, which would be the individual seeking employment, conducts a thorough investigation and background check into the individual based on what the individual has spoken or said with their mouth, and finds out that what they have said is not true. Therefore, they've either hyperbolized, which means exaggerated, or they have simply lied, which means something told with the deliberate intent to deceive. In either case, what one has spoken has been to their own detriment. Are you listening to me? And so this is how it is. Recently, I was reading of an investor over in Europe that had worked for a stock market firm. They did a background check. They did not find out that he had a criminal record, and he mismanaged over $156 million. And this is all because they did not thoroughly check his background. I'm simply giving these illustrations to us tonight because it is important that we recognize that what we say comes from what we think. All thoughts or all speech is the byproduct of what is formulated in our thinking. And sometimes we do not necessarily think before we speak, but we have to think because speaking is a skill that is a motor skill that is controlled by the psyche, the Greek word for the mind. And then there's that area of your brain, I believe somewhere in this hemisphere, the frontal lobe of the hemisphere that controls the ability for people to speak. This is what God has ordained to control once he gives us the baptism of the Holy Spirit. When we come and after hearing the gospel, and of course we hear the gospel because somebody has someone say speaking. God has allowed someone to hear, believe, obey the gospel, be prepared to go forth and preach the gospel. We preach the gospel, which means we speak it with our mouth. Go and preach, he said, which means go and speak. Preach means to expound and or to foretell and or expound the word of God pertaining to the message that we have been ordained to preach, which is the gospel, which is defined as the death, burial, resurrection, and ascension of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So this is what we expound: his death, that he died, that he was buried, that he rose the third day, ascended up on high, and there is the Lamb of God that came to take away the sins of the world. There, the blood of the Lamb is presented by he himself, who is the high priest, sits down on the throne and becomes the God that received the blood of the Lamb at the hands of the high priest. One person functioning in three different capacities. And in fact, none of us would have salvation if he had not done this. If he did this all by himself. This is why in one place he said he took his own arm and brought salvation. So we have salvation today. We have access to the presence of God, which is what we were going to teach on tonight. But it is important that we get down to some of the specifics that pertain to our everyday life, that are relevant to our conduct and our behavior. And speaking has much to do with it, because we do a great deal of speaking. We probably do more speaking than we do of anything else. And that's why the cell phone industry and the telecommunications industry is such big business, because almost everyone has a cell phone. Let me see the hands of those who have a cell phone. Turn to someone and say, my. Yes, all of us have cell phones because we're constantly communicating, we're talking, we're speaking, we're saying things. And this then is because we have to communicate in order for us to conduct our affairs. But we must understand that our communication now is supposed to be controlled by the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit that God gave us as a gift, as a part of the plan of salvation, is supposed to inspire us to speak according to the Holy Scriptures. And so then we are told in one place, let no corrupt communication proceed out of thy mouth. So regardless of whether or not we believe it or not, we are not supposed to be speaking anything corrupt. I just gave you the scripture in St. Matthew 12:36, I think it is, that every idle word man shall speak, he shall give an account of in the day of judgment. And by your words shall ye just be justified, and by your words shall ye be condemned. And because so many people do not believe that God is involved in the daily affairs of humanity, they do any and say any and every kind of thing that you could possibly imagine. They don't think that they're going to have to give an account of it. And so now we're going to read from the 39th book of the Old Testament, which is the book of Malachi, chapter number 3. This is the last of the Old Testament books. Someone say the 39th book. And in this particular book, remember now, there are 39 books in the Old, 27 in the New, 40 authors in the Bible. And of course, 17 books of prophecy, 4 gospels, 1 book of history in the New Testament, 21 New Testament epistles, and of course, 1 book of prophecy called the book of Revelation. You and I are obligated to know our Bible. Turn to your neighbor and say, know your Bible. Because the Bible says in St. Matthew 4:4 and St. Luke 4:4, that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. So we are obligated to know the scriptures. And this is simply what I attempt to do, is to impart to you, as I have the opportunity to do so, as is the obligation, of course, placed upon me, and as much as I am called, prepared, and sent to do this, to impart that level of knowledge and understanding of the same to you in the framework of the wisdom of God. Now, knowledge has to do with no logos. It has to do with knowing God, or no logos, knowing the Word of God, having insight into what the Word of God says. Understanding is understanding the sense of what it means. Wisdom is the ability to use the knowledge of God and the understanding of the same to the glory of God, or to perfection, or to completing and allowing the will of God to be completed in the life of the believer. This is not rocket science. It sounds difficult. It is not. Turn to someone and say, his yoke is easy and his burden is light. So I can impart these things to you. If you will practice them, they will become a part, not of your second nature, they will become a part of who you are. Your lifestyle, your manner of living, your conversation, as all these things are found in the scripture, will ultimately these things take hold and they become who you are. And you actually become indignant against unrighteousness. You become bothered by evil. You become discerning of things around you that are just not right. Can the church say amen? Amen. Now, in the book of Malachi, this is the last of the Old Testament books, the last of the 17 Old Testament books of prophecy. Some refer to him as a minor prophet. I don't know how he could be minor. All the prophecies are major. All the prophecies are important. Much of that which has been divided into minor and major prophets or minor and major books of prophecy has to do with volume of prophecy, but it is not consistent. Therefore, we should understand we will simply deal with this as the 17th book of Old Testament prophecy, the 39th book of the Old Testament. Are you listening to me? And in this particular book, you will find that there were seven charges. God brought seven charges against the Levitical priesthood in the book of Malachi. And after each charge that God brought against them by the mouth of the prophet Malachi, who someone said, say this with me, he spoke it. That means these charges came out of Malachi's mouth. He was given the inspiration and the ordination by God to write them down and put them in print for us. And of course, they argued with him after each charge. And I gave you those 17 charges. I will give them again to you at the end of Bible class if I have time. But we are here, not 70 charges, the seven charges. I'll give these seven charges to you again at the end of Bible class if we have time. The seventh charge is in verse 13 and 14. And we're going to pick up the conclusion of the book, or the conclusion of the writing, or the conclusion of the prophecy. Are you listening to me? Verse number 15 now. If you have it, we're going to read down to verse number 18. And we're talking about, repeat after me, someone say, our speech. What comes out of our mouth. All right, let's read on. And now we call the proud happy. Everyone reading? Yea, they that work wickedness are set up. Yea, they that tempt God are even delivered. Then they that fear the Lord spake often one to another, and the Lord hearkened and heard it, and a book of remembrance was written before him for them that feared the Lord and that thought upon his name. And they shall be mine, saith the Lord of hosts, in that day when I make up my jewels, and I will spare them as a man spareth his own son that serveth him. Then shall ye return and discern between the righteous and the wicked, between him that serveth God and him that serveth him not. Now, I am clear in verse 18, it is dealing with after God responds to them that fear him, that speak often one to another about him, and a book of remembrance is written before him for them that fear the Lord. Verse 16 is where I'm quoting from and reading from, and that thought upon his name. What's his name? Jesus Christ. You should understand then that God hears what we speak. If we're going to have conversations, we need to be very careful that our conversations are within the framework of the scriptures, or within the framework of truth, put it that way. And a lot of times we say things, we talk about things, we talk about people, and we say things that we do not know what we're talking about. And this is why in the book of Jude and Peter it says, these speak evil of things that they know not. There are many people that talk about and say things they shouldn't say. Now this is why, even though I hate to bring this up or hurt your feelings, many people don't like me for saying this, but being a Republican, I did not vote for Bill Clinton, but when Bill Clinton got in trouble, it was the responsibility of the House and the Senate ethics to deal with whether or not they would impeach him. Now, of course, the House did impeach him. Tom DeLay, who was a personal friend, I know Tom DeLay personally, met him in Washington, D.C. after Mike Rogers was elected to Congress, spent an entire day with him, but he was a bit enraged. I think he was a little bit more emotional than what he should have been. And he went after Bill Clinton because he wanted him to be impeached. He was impeached by the House, but the Senate blocked it. It didn't go through. The economy was doing well, and quite frankly, no one wanted to see Bill Clinton removed from office because everybody was making money. Someone say money. And when you're making money, no one wanted to upset the economy. But the bottom line is that it was not our job to speak against him or say things against him other than that his conduct was unbecoming of a person that holds that office. Certainly he acknowledged that he did this. He was to be certainly criticized for his misconduct in the office. But any other derogatory remarks, certainly I was not involved in them. Those who remember me in this pulpit, I was very careful not to say anything derogatory about Bill Clinton. He was a very smart man, a Rhodes Scholar, graduate of the House of Rhodes in Oxford, England, Oxford University. I've been to Oxford University. Brother Crump studied at Oxford University legitimately and formally. I studied at Oxford on a ticket with the Oxford Club with a bunch of rich people. I went there and paid for 1 week. I don't know how long he stayed, but it is a very prestigious academic institution of higher learning and education. And Bill Clinton was a graduate of the House of Rhodes, and it was our responsibility to do what the scripture says. And the scripture tells us to pray for kings, leaders, and rulers. That's why when people criticize George Bush, who is, by the way, a personal friend, the day Dick Cheney was in town, and I was supposed to meet him with Congressman Wahlberg. But I did not have time to go down and meet Dick Cheney again because I have had so many meetings with Dick Cheney, my head hurts. So he is a personal friend, but I don't need that anymore. I've had that experience. But we're not to criticize these people. We are to do what? Pray for them. And pray for them. You have many people making a lot of remarks that they need to shut them. I hate to have to say it like that. They need to shut their mouths because you don't know what you're talking about. And I tell people that often, if you don't know the person, just shut up. Because President Bush is a God-fearing man. He's very sincere about his faith as a Methodist. He worships God and he practices morality, loves his wife, takes care of his family, and does what he thinks is right as the president of the most powerful democracy in the free world. And so I'm simply using that as an illustration, starting from the top down, that you have to be careful about what you say about people. Best thing to do is to do what the scripture said. Say what the scripture said. Pray for them. Turn to someone and say, pray for them. Now, Governor Granholm, likewise, she's the governor. She won. I wrote her a letter and sent her a reward. She wrote a letter back. We have an amicable relationship. We don't agree. We're on different sides of the aisle. But I pray for her. And on my television show, I let those who are speaking from my side of the aisle know that I don't have any further criticism of her. Simply will say these are things that need to be addressed. I will address the issues without getting into criticizing personalities. Are you listening to me? And this is what you have to be careful about with any and everyone, about saying things about people and against people, and particularly people in leadership as well as people who belong to the house of God. If a person has come into the church and has experienced the new birth experience, You need to be very careful about what you say about them. And if you're not in a position to address them directly, to encourage them in some fashion with respect to something you have seen or something you have heard, the best thing to do is leave people alone, mind your own business, and pray for them. Can the church say amen? So now, verse 16, then they that feared the Lord spake often one to another. This has to do with, someone say, fellowship. Now this is spake often. They would have to, then in that day, they did not have cell phones. They did not have computers, the internet, and all of this modern technology that we can use now, MyFace, MySpace, the YouTube, GodTube. There's a whole list and host of things that people are using to communicate. I looked on the internet the other day, and someone had made a MySpace, MyFace for me. I don't even know how to use the internet. And I was wondering, now, who put this up as MySpace? Because I don't have any space. My space is in heaven. Can the church say amen? But they had it, and it looked nice. It was very impressive, but I didn't have anything to do with it. But these modern means of technology have afforded us this ability. Are you listening to me? Now, in that day, they did not have any such thing. They could not possibly fathom the things that you and I are benefiting from as far as contemporary society is concerned, with respect to the comforts of modern technology and the quality of life that all of us enjoy. Transportation was not there. Telecommunications was not there. Electricity wasn't there. Controlled environments such as what we sit in on tonight, with heat that basically controls the temperature of the room in which we sit in here tonight, television, and all these other things, they simply did not exist in that day. So they would have to come in contact with one another, and they would have to, Brother Selby, have direct communication with each other through fellowship. Then they that feared the Lord spake often. That means that they assembled in some form or fashion so that they could, in fact, speak to each other. And no doubt what they were speaking, obviously from the scripture here, was edifying. Because if they were saying something that was not edifying, it certainly would have been addressed, in as much as God has brought 7 charges against the priests. And after bringing 7 charges against the priests in the book of Malachi, then he speaks of those that fear the Lord, that spake often one to another, obviously saying the things they should be saying, sharing the things they should be sharing, and communicating and fellowshipping as they should be fellowshipping. The term fellowship means they were touching and agreeing on the same thing. According to 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse number 10, that I would that there be no division among you, but that you all speak the same thing. That's in your Bible, 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse number 10. We should all speak the what? The same thing. So this then is what I am starting off tonight with, so that we will get it, that sometimes we speak ourselves into depression. You listen to this rap and hip-hop music of these demon-possessed rappers. Yes, get this on the YouTube. And all of these hip-hop artists that are spewing out this poison and gangster rap, and even some of those who are involved in rock and roll music. And what happens is we're listening to the speech of foul and unclean spirits. And they're spewing all this poison out here. And when you listen to that, you just listen to that which forces your psyche into depression. Next thing you know, your thinking is all twisted. You're wondering why you're feeling burdened, or why you're feeling sick, or why you're feeling lethargic, apathetic, or defeated. It's because you've allowed your spirit, not you, but someone who's listening to this has allowed their spirit to be corrupted and poisoned by what they're listening to. And then when you get here, I'm trying to sing a gospel song to get you in the frame of mind to worship God. And if you have all of that garbage that has been placed in there through listening to the music that is inspired by corruption or by the spirit of corruption through rappers, R&B artists, rock and roll artists, and or hip-hop artists, then first of all, you have to be delivered from that torment. before we can get the word of God in your spirit. Can the church say amen? Well, these that feared the Lord, they had dismissed these things, no doubt, from their life. Because the Bible says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. And then, of course, 12th chapter of Ecclesiastes, he said, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God will bring every work into judgment, whether it be good or whether it be evil. Can the church say amen? So they that what? Feared the Lord, spake often. Now, we have set up our churches where you can come to church on Tuesday for Bible class if you can't make it on Friday. On Friday if you can't make it on Tuesday, or on Tuesday and Friday if you choose to come to either one. The students' Bible classes are on Wednesday at University of Michigan and at Michigan State on Wednesday. Then we have a Bible class in Dearborn for some of the members that only make it on Sunday, at the Hyatt Regency now on Mondays. And then we, of course, do home Bible classes for those we have to go in and teach and instruct in their homes. Are you listening to me? But we are constantly instructing people in the word of the Lord. Can the church say hallelujah? Hallelujah. Now let us go then to the book of Psalms 15. We're talking about our speech. Psalms 15 and verse number 1 through 5. The entire psalm. Psalms 15. Someone say Psalms 15. I'll give you some time to go there. But I'm trying to help us understand that our speech, someone say our speech. Mm-hmm. All right, if you have that, can you say amen? If you love the Lord, can you say thank you, Jesus? Let's read now. Lord, who shall abide in thy tabernacle? Who shall dwell in thy holy hill? Now, you can write next to or in your notes somewhere, the tabernacle and holy hill of the Lord is the New Testament church. Today, no longer are we worshiping at the tabernacle or the temple. The tabernacle was given to Moses, continued until Solomon built Solomon's temple in his day. And of course, then that was torn down, and then Zerubbabel's temple was built, and then that was torn down, and then Herod's temple was built. And the holy hill is that hill, the northwest hill of Jerusalem. This is where the temple was built on that holy hill. We know it as Mount Moriah. Today sits on that hill the Muslim Mosque of Omar. It is sacred to Jews, Christians, and Muslims alike. And of course, that was the place where Solomon's temple was built. The Dome of the Rock is inside. And that will be the place where, after the church is raptured, the Jews will rebuild their temple and resume their temple worship during what has become known as the tribulation period, the 7-year tribulation period that will follow the rapture of the church. Now, Brother Treadway met with one of the Jews at the prison who told him the stones of the temple have already been cut. They're in storage. And they have been in negotiations for some time to get control of the site. And once they get control of the site, they will rebuild. They will tear down the Muslim mosque, rebuild their temple, and resume their temple worship for a time. But you and I will be raptured. We'll be out of here. Turn to someone and say, I'm up out of here. Now, if you're going to be in the church, you'll be up out of here. God will have caught you up to meet the Lord in the air. That has not taken place yet, but it will be very soon. And of course, this is just the way it will be. But this is what verse number 1 is referring to. It's referring to the New Testament church, the spiritual church, a church known to us today as the body of Christ. Can the church say the body of Christ? Verse 2, let's read. He that walketh uprightly and worketh righteousness and speaketh the truth in his heart. Now, of course, speak of the truth in his heart. Someone said, well, that means I just need to speak the truth in me. No. You speak the truth that is in your heart. The truth comes out of your heart. So don't get confused here.